ज्ञानतिमिरान्तस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनि नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। Hare Krishna, we welcome all of you. Sorry for the delay today. We had some technical problems here. This is the topic for today. You are showing it? You show it? Huh? Okay. I'm going to start from this only. Signal is coming or not? Hare Krishna. Can I start? It's coming. So dealing with the family attachment, the very important topic for today. I actually wanted to do both for the students and for the married people both. Let us see how it goes. Here is a lecture by Srila Prabhupada. Is family a stumbling block in bhakti? So Prabhupada is saying here, Griheshu Saktasya. Generally people become too much attached to family life. I sometimes say that in the Western countries, Prabhupada says their only great asset is they are not family-wise attached, Prabhupada is saying. And that is very good qualification, he says. And then he says in India, they have got organized family attachment. We have shown the picture of a big family, joint family. And he says that they are not interested in Krishna consciousness. And now they are after money now. So Prabhupada says, in India the families are strongly networked. You know, husband, wife, children, mother, father, grandmother, grandfather, uncle, aunt, like that. And they also feel a very strong sense of family responsibility towards each other. So one of the things that absorbs their mind is the affection and attachment for the family members, and secondly the worry or anxiety about bringing money to the family in a responsible way and settling everybody in the family in proper life. This absorbs them. So this type of attachment for the family members and attachment for money, Prabhupada says, keeps them very absorbed, and they are not able to take out time for Krishna consciousness. This is 1970s, Prabhupada is saying, 1976, he's saying in Vrindavan lecture, he's saying. On the other hand, he says, in the Western world, the families are all disintegrated. So a boy or a girl leaves home at 13. And there is no family-wise attachment. So people, therefore, take out time to become attached to God, he's saying. And then, here is a photo of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who had 10 children, and he and his wife Bhagavati Devi, they had 10 children. It's a big family. Let us see what Prabhupada says about this family.
Close.
So, what Prabhupada says about this family of Bhaktivinoda Thakur? He says that the family attachment is the greatest impediment in the matter of advancing in Krishna consciousness. But if the whole family is Krishna conscious, that is very nice. Just like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he says, he was a family man, but all of the Bhaktivinoda Thakur's, his wife, children, and the best children is our Guru Maharaj, which is Bhakti Sansarasi Thakur, is saying about that best child. And then he says, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has sung in a song, Yedi na grihe bhajana deki grihete goloka bhai. He's singing, when I return back in the evening to my home, my children are playing mridangam, kartal, some child is worshipping the deity of Krishna, and they all have brilliant, bright faces. And so Prabhupada says, if family-wise everyone is engaged in Krishna service, that is very nice. That is not ordinary family. That attachment is not ordinary attachment, he's saying. That means that whole family, although he had a very big family, their goal was not sense gratification. Their goal was Krishna service. So therefore, it's a very special spiritual family, he says. So you understand the difference. Here in the previous slide, Prabhupada was saying that Indians are focused towards the material family responsibilities and money making, and it becomes an endless game throughout the life, even after one becomes very old also. On the other hand, here he says another Indian family, Bhaktivinoda Thakur's family, he is praising this family, although it's a very big family. Somebody may say, such a big samsari, 10 children, but Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote more than 100 books. And he also was a high court magistrate. And he wrote a book called as Godruma Kalpatavi, and more than 2500 Namahatta Bhakti Vriksha centers he had opened in different parts of Bengal when he was in Godrum Dweep, guiding so many preachers. So in this way, for Bhaktivinoda Thakur, the family did not become a stumbling block in his devotional service. Rather, the family enhanced his devotional service. Therefore, if a family is a Krishna conscious family, Prabhupada says, then they are attached to Krishna. That's very wonderful. It's not a problem even if they have too many members in a family. So one thing becomes clear to you in these two slides. Here what is being condemned is forgetting Krishna and becoming attached to a big joint family for getting some mutual love and affection and money making and taking responsibility. You will find that even the lion teaches the cub how to catch the prey. Even animals actually take care of their offsprings also. So in the first slide, Prabhupada is condemning about just doing family duties without any Krishna consciousness. So he's condemning that. Here he's appreciating running a samsara family along with Krishna consciousness is glorifying. So here he's saying, Griheva vanete tako haha ha gauranga bole dake. He's saying it doesn't matter either he is in family life or he is in sannyasi life. If he is a devotee, then his life is successful. So here is comparing the two. Somebody may be a sannyasi, somebody may be a grihastha. It's immaterial what you are, he is saying. And if they are Krishna conscious, then they both are successful, he is saying. And then he is also saying, everyone is thinking that my family, my wife, my children, my nation, my community, that is everything. What is Krishna? I have no time for Krishna. So he says, this is illusion. This is called as family-centeredness, my job-centeredness, and Krishna-forgetfulness. That is what he is calling as Maya. And then Prabhupada says, everything will be finished. Nobody can give us any protection except Krishna. So yesterday we were talking about taking shelter of Krishna, being fixed in Krishna's lotus feet. So he's saying we must take shelter of Krishna's lotus feet through the spiritual master and live with the devotees. So I will show you one section of Srimad Bhagavatam now. This is 7th canto, 14th chapter, where Yudhishthira Maharaj is asking the question here. Shri Yudhishthira Uvacha Grihastha Grihastha Etam Padavim Vidhina Yena Chanjasa Yaya Devarsher Bruhir Madrisho Grihamudadhi. He's telling Yudhishthira Maharaj to Narada, "Oh my Lord, O great sage, kindly explain how we people who are staying at home without knowledge of the goal of life may also easily attain liberation according to the instructions of the Vedas." He's telling Narada, "You are a brahmachari, but we are grihasthas. You have no other business. You know, you can take your veena, fly here, fly there, preach Krishna consciousness. And for you to be 24/7, being with God is a very easy thing because you don't have family obligations. You don't have professional obligations. You are a free bird. But what about us? We have mother, father, wife, children, family. With all these things, how are we to do our bhakti?" So you can see this. My request to all of you, audience today, attending the program today, 7th canto, 14th chapter. You can read this Srimad Bhagavatam called Ideal Family Life. Very valuable chapter. All grihasthas should go through this. Very nice. And then Prabhupada says here that he talks about the four ashramas and everything. So, and here Prabhupada says that as soon as possible, one should give up his so-called comfortable life at home and prepare to undergo tapasya, austerity. Because tapo divyam, if we do some tapasya for Krishna's pleasure, our heart gets purified and then we can attain the ultimate goal of life. So, and then Narada is further telling him, Shri Narada Vuvacha Griheshu Avastito Rajan Kriyakur Manjato Chitaha Vasudevarpanam Sakshat Upasita Mahamunin. Is telling, my dear king, those who stay at home as householders must act to earn their livelihood. That means, if a man is married, he cannot run away from wife and children and go to ISKCON temple and say, "I will stay with brahmacharis," because there is too much headache at home. This is becoming difficult for me. Like one boy wrote a letter to me asking, "Prabhu, when I see the household responsibilities, I am too afraid. So many sisters are to be married and settled. You know, my earning of father, mother is not much. So a whole thing will come on me. So I thought I will run away from family. And then just go to the temple and leave. Because in temple I can forget, just chant and dance." No. Here Narada is clearly saying here, those who are grihasthas, those who stay at home as householders must act to earn their livelihood. Because if he doesn't bring money, then how will the family run? So it is his duty. Similarly, some students asked me in the last few days that once I came to Krishna consciousness, it became like nectar for me. And I started hating my academics. So can I just, you know, forego the academics and just chant and dance? You see, this is actually the cheating of the mind. Because the mind wants to take an easy escape route to avoid the responsibilities of the world. And in the name of Krishna consciousness. So they are using Krishna consciousness as a escape route for not studying. So on the other hand, you will see Lord Krishna tells Arjuna, in one of the verses he says, Mamanusmara yudhyacha. He says that, remembering me, you should do the fighting. That means Krishna is telling him, you should not run away from your duties. At the same time, you should not forget me also. You should remember me and do your duties. Like that he says, Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mamanas marayudhyacha mayyar pitamano buddhir mame vashyasi asamshayaha. He is saying that if you invest your remembrance in me and then with your hands and legs do your work to earn your livelihood, everything. So one has to do it. You know, some of you had asked the question that, oh, life is too tedious in the job. So I am planning to devote one session for the profession separately. Attitude towards profession. But today we will talk about attitude towards family. So here he says that instead of trying to enjoy the results of their work themselves, they should offer these results to Krishna, Vasudev. How to satisfy Vasudev in this life can be perfectly understood through the association of great devotees of the Lord. He's saying. And then here you will find subsequent next one. See, Prabhupada is saying here, in India, the principles of this science were followed strictly. Even 50 years ago, I saw in the villages of Bengal and suburbs of Calcutta, people engaged in hearing Srimad Bhagavatam daily. when all their activities ended, or at least in the evening before going to bed. Everyone would hear Bhagavatam. Bhagavat classes were held in every village, and thus people had the advantage of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, which describes everything about the aim of life, liberation or salvation. This will be clearly explained in the next verses. In South India, I heard there were, in public places, there was Ramanuja Kutiram, they call it, which means they used to have public kutirs, where there will be a dais kind of thing, round or square one, and there will be poles on four places, and then there will be a, covering at the top, so if rain comes, no water will come in. But in the sides, it will be open. So in the evening, after people come from their jobs at 5 o'clock or something, everybody would gather there. Like that, Ramanuja had made 5,000, I heard. 5,000 kutirams, Ramanuja kutiram in different parts of South India. Why? So the grihasthas can come back in the evening and come together and do hearing such Srimad Bhagavatam. That was the idea. So, then he says here, Shrinvan Bhagavato Vikshnam Avatarakatamratam Shraddadano Yathakalam Upashanta Janavratah. He is saying that here a grihastha must associate again and again with saintly persons, and with great respect he must hear the nectar of the activities of the Supreme Lord and his incarnations. That means Krishna's different avatars, Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narsingha. Similarly, he comes as Rama, he comes as Vishnu. All these avatars we should hear. And these activities are described in Srimad Bhagavatam and other Puranas. Thus, one should gradually become detached from the affection for his wife and children, exactly like a man awakening from a dream. That means what he is saying here, that in our family, there are so many family members, mother, father, husband, wife, children, family members. We should see that they all are put in my custody by Krishna. They are all children of Krishna, part and parcel of Krishna. They are put in my custody. I should actually safely cross them beyond this ocean of samsara and take them back home, back to Godhead. For that duty, Lord has put them under me. On the contrary, if I become attached to them, and again, I keep taking birth over and over again, and I become lazy in spiritual life. A typical life in India, you will see people on Sunday get up very late in the morning, and they take bath at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, and then they watch TV or read a newspaper or read a supplement, and afternoon eat out in a hotel. Even many so-called good families also, this is a typical schedule in India. So many people, weekend, they think it is meant for lazily just enjoying sense gratification. So here Prabhupada says how a husband is the leader of the family, he is supposed to be very responsible. He himself should be Krishna conscious and assist his wife and children in developing love for Krishna. That's a duty. So in this way, and Prabhupada says here, Abhikshna means we should hear again and again. There is no question of stopping. Even if one has read these topics many times, you should go on reading again and again, because Bhagavad Gita, word spoken by Krishna, is like Amritam, he says. And then Prabhupada says here, see, this is a very important purpose. This is what I want to show you here. The human form of life is meant for liberation, but unfortunately, due to the influence of Kali Yuga, every day the grihasthas are working hard like asses. Early in the morning, they rise and travel even 100 miles away from to earn bread. Especially in the Western countries, I have seen that people awaken at 5 o'clock to go to offices and factories to earn their livelihood. People in Calcutta and Bombay also do this every day. They work very hard in the office and factory, and again they spend 3 or 4 hours in transportation and returning home. Then they retire at 10 o'clock and again rise early in the morning to go to their offices and factories. This kind of hard labor is described in Shastra as the life of pigs and stool eaters. Nayam deho deha bhajam re loke kashtan kamana hrute vidubu jamye. And then he is quoting that verse, what Rishabhadev talks about the hard-working animals. So one must find some time for hearing Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. This is Vedic culture. And then Prabhupada says here, see, this is a very important thing here he says here. See what he says. One should work 8, Aribol, you are showing it now? Yeah. One should work 8 hours at the most to earn his livelihood. And either in the afternoon or in the evening, the householder should associate with devotees to hear about the incarnations of Krishna and his activities, and thus be gradually liberated from clutches of Maya, he says. So which means, some of you may say that, Prabhu, instead of working for 8 hours, I am working 14 hours. You may say that. So therefore he says here that in 8 hours whatever money you get, that is the money which fills your pocket. Within that we should learn to lead our life. Simplify, simplify, simplify. Make our material life simple and very easy to live, so that we will not need too much money. Then we will have time for Krishna, like that he is saying. However, instead of finding time to hear about Krishna, the householders, after working hard in office and factories, find time to go to a restaurant or a club where, instead of hearing about Krishna and his activities, they are very much pleased to hear about the political activities of demons and non-devotees, and to enjoy sex, wine, women and meat in this way waste their time. This is not grihastha life but demoniac life. The Krishna consciousness movement, however, with its centers all over the world, gives such fallen and condemned persons an opportunity to hear about Krishna. So in this way, and then Prabhupada says, in dream we form a society of friendship and love, and when we awaken we see that it has ceased to exist. For example, we were attached to mother and father, but mother and father eventually they pass away. We were attached to our mother's mother, father's father and all of them. They all have passed away one by one, so it's like a dream. They live with us for a while and then they go away. One by one everybody in this world goes like that. Similarly, one's gross society, family and love are also a dream, and this dream will be over as soon as one dies. Therefore, whether one is dreaming in a subtle way or gross way, these dreams are all false and temporary. One's real business is to understand that one is a soul and that his activities should therefore be different. Then one can be happy, he says. So, this way it goes on. So I will leave this chapter to you, 7th canto, 14th chapter, 7.14. You read it. I gave you a sample of this. Many other responsibilities of grihastha, Prabhupada will say here. So now we will proceed further. Griheva vanete tako ha gauranga bole dake. Prabhupada says that, he's singing that song, that whether you are a grihastha or a brahmachari or a sannyasi, it's immaterial as long as you are Krishna conscious. So now, the griha medhi word is used. See, medhi means a pole like this, where a bull goes round and round. You've seen that, they call it Kolluka Bail in India, we call it. So if somebody makes the enjoyment at home, like watching TV, reading newspaper, you know, eating out in a hotel, you know, just chatting and joking and enjoying with talking to the family members, you know, and talking about politics, talking about all the worldly activities, and there is not an iota of anything to do with Krishna consciousness, such a family is called as a Grihamedi family for sense gratification. On the other hand, here it says here, if you see, even though everyone starts every day with the same 24 hours, the persons who are more serious in spiritual life, they find more time to devote themselves to filling their day with Krishna-centered activities. Simply living in a home with a husband or wife or children doesn't make one a grihastha. Like one man told his own Jayadutta Maharaj, said, Maharaj, I am Vanapras. He said, Vanapras, what do you do? Oh, no, I am retired now, I don't go to job, I am staying at home reading newspaper, watching TV, taking my grandson for a walk. Maharaj said, what kind of Vanapras is this? What are you doing for Krishna? What are you doing in spiritual life? So, similarly, just marrying and living with a wife, going for a job, making money and eating and sleeping, that is not grihastha life. A grihamedhi is one who lives externally in a grihastha environment, but whose goal of life is sense enjoyment. So this is the main difference. Grihamedhi means his goal of life is sense enjoyment, material sense enjoyment, whereas a devotee means self-control and self-realization. That's what makes one a grihastha. A grihastha lives a God-centered life. He knows the ultimate goal of life, but is not able to be completely renounced. One understands that I need a mother, father, I need a wife and children. So he accepts the family life, he does the profession, earns money. But his goal is not to just enjoy life. His goal is to purify the heart by Krishna consciousness and go back to God. Like here you can see, please read it.
Grihamedhi versus Grihastha. Grihastha means that it's called ashrama, grihastha ashrama, to live with wife and children. But the business is how to develop Krishna consciousness. Grihamedhi, and where there is no such attempt how to develop Krishna consciousness, simply living like cats and dogs. They have also sex life. They also produce children. they also eat, they also work, such kind of life, household life, working day and night simply for sense pleasure.
Yeah. So you clearly understand the difference. If somebody lives like any other animal, then they are called as Grihamedi. Grihastha means to live with wife and children, but the business is how to develop Krishna consciousness. Here you are seeing a young couple going to a temple for darshan. You look at their faces, it's lit up. Both are wearing tilak, they have bead bag, they are taking darshan. That means they are getting some rasa, juice, by taking darshan of the deities, coming to the temple. They are modestly dressed. Mataji is dressed in a sari, Prabhuji is in dhoti kurta. That means they have started practicing Krishna consciousness seriously. And they are going towards Krishna. That is grihastha life. Yeah.
Grihasthas can worship the deities at home, distribute Srila Prabhupada books, raise children in Krishna consciousness by setting a good example and preach to the best of their capacity.
Yeah. So they can do many things in society. Like here you see one of the grihastha men offering flower to the deities. So in the Narada Muni's instruction specifically he says that grihastha should have a deity at home and worship. Why? Because we all have attachment, bodily attachment. For example, a grihastha while raising a baby, when the baby is growing up, naturally you become very much attached to the child. Even when the child goes to school, you remember the child. So then that gradually forms a very strong tendency for mental attachment. I always have fear, nothing should happen and things like that. But if you worship the deity form of the Lord, you get to touch the deity, bathe the deity, dress the deity, and decorate the deity. So in the same manner, the attachment to deities develops. In 7.1, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Maya saktamana partha yogam yunjan madashrayah asamshayam samagrammam yatajnyasasita chrunu. Arjuna, I will tell you how you can develop attachment for me, Krishna says. So, a grihastha man who is doing puja like this, besides developing attachment to family members, he develops attachment to Krishna. And he is able to elevate all family members to attachment to Krishna. This is a secret actually. By worshipping the deity with all the paraphernalia on a daily basis, grihastha should try to do Mangalarti in the morning. If they cannot, for some reason they want to chant their rounds and rush to office, then they can come back in the evening and do Gaurarati. At least Gaurarati or Mangalarti. One out of the two arthis minimum should be done in the home. Then Narsingarati, then offering water to Tulasi, circumambulating Tulasi, then chanting 16 rounds. Then they can be called as grihastha. Similarly, one Mataji, she had a newborn child, which was about 3 months or 4 months old. So this Mataji wrote a letter to her spiritual master and said, Maharaj, in the last 4-5 years, I have been going out to distribute Prabhupada books, putting book table, and I have been selling on an average during marathon about 2,000 books, 1,500-2,000 books. Me and my husband and some of our friends, we all went and put table in the bus stand and we were selling the books. And we also got so many contacts. And many of those ladies I have been cultivating. But now that I have got a child now, my whole attention is now going to child and I am not getting to distribute books. So then the spiritual master told her, you see, now your duty is to take care of the child. Child is a very tender child. Child requires attention. And that is also service. That is also very essential. And then he told her, you contact that senior lady Mataji, she will give you some training on how to raise your child very nicely, especially a small child. When child grows a little bit, then you will get more time. And at the same time, in case you get some time, you can always preach through Zoom or phone calls to different people. You may not be able to go and put book table. So in this way, and then her guru told, I am so proud of you that even while having a small baby, your heart is longing to do some sankirtan. And this lady, this Mataji is calling different people who are newly coming to Krishna consciousness. And she is selling Srimad Bhagavatam sets on phone, inspiring them to buy Bhagavatam sets. She has a baby in her lap, but she is selling Bhagavatam sets on phone, simply by calling them. So in this way, this is what we are trying to say, that they have to pay attention to wife, children, family, but they have to give their heart to Krishna like this and preach to the best of their ability. See here, the do's and don'ts are given for the grihasthas. Yeah, read it.
Do's are: the following recommendations for making spiritual advancement are important because they are practical even in the present age. Rising early in the morning and taking a bath.
It's called Brahma Muhurtam. For that night, one has to sleep at 9, 9:30, latest by 10. And morning, if they sleep at 10, they can get up at 4 or 4:30. So then get ready, and that time is very conducive for chanting. According to even scientists, they say our mind is like a wax in the morning, or like a wet cement. In wet cement, if somebody walks with their shoe, it makes an impression. Like that in the morning, the mind is very calm, cool, collected. All the people in the world are also sleeping, so no disturbance. Like for example, imagine if all the population of the world gets up. In the daytime, all of them are awake. So their minds, their brains are sending out lot of signals. Receiving signals and sending out signals. Their desires, their plans, their activities, their enviousness and sense gratificatory propensities, everything is coming out of their head and going into their head. So a lot of traffic in the daytime. In the morning, because everybody is fast asleep, the traffic is practically very, very little. Very few people are up in the morning. And I am not talking about the traffic on the road. That is also little in the morning. The road traffic also, I have traveled many times early morning. The road is practically empty in the morning time. And in the night time, you will see 9 to 10, 10:30, heavy traffic in the night. People returning from company. Just as the road traffic is practically nil in the morning, similarly, especially the signals coming from the people's brains is also practically nil. So, when you make a sankalpa that I want to become a devotee of Krishna, I want to advance, nobody's desire can interfere with you in the early morning hours. So, you can have a proper desire and you can strengthen that desire. So, those who are rising early in the morning, they are very intelligent. Early to bed and early to rise makes you healthy, wealthy and wise, we say. Yes, go ahead, read it.
Greeting and worshipping the deities.
Yes.
Chanting the prescribed number of rounds attentively and with devotion. This is a vital aspect of devotional service.
Yeah, grihasthas should complete the rounds in the morning, or if they have 2 or 4 rounds, they can do in the evening. But mostly they should finish, and they should not chant in the counters and other things. We should actually chant in the mala. Why? Because the mala is Tulasi mala, and Guru has chanted in it. So there is special power in this. So one has to chant in this. And even if you are not initiated yet, say you have a mala in which you are chanting, and you are sitting in front of the Lord in the puja room with no other distraction, chanting, that is more absorbing rather than just having a counter and chanting it in the train, bus, here, there. Extra rounds you can do, but 16 rounds you should try to do in the puja room in front of the Lord. Go ahead.
Worshipping Tulsi Devi. Hearing, reading.
Oh, watering Tulasi every day is very vital, because Tulasi Devi is Krishna Bhakti Pradayini. She can give devotional service, yeah.
Hearing, reading daily from scriptures like Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita.
Yeah, if you don't read daily, it's like not eating grains. On Ekadashi day, you don't eat grains, so you feel weak. Similarly, if you don't read regularly Gita Bhagavatam, in spiritual life, you will feel weak and Maya will become very attractive and very, very powerful. Yeah. Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami in Chaitanya Charitamrita says that. Go ahead.
Offering bhoga and honoring prasad, Vaishnavas and Brahmanas, performing charity in the mode of goodness, performing sacrifices, the best being the Sankirtan Yajna, devotional service unto the Lord is the most important feature of Grihastha life. In essence, Namaruchi, Jivadaya and Vaishnava Seva.
These are all very simple things. If you take note of these things and faithfully execute them, one's Grihastha life can be very successful. And some don'ts.
A Grihastha should not do anything that is not related to Krishna, and he should not unnecessarily mingle with materialistic people.
Yeah, actually, in the name of making friendships with materialistic people, then there can be a proportionate damage in our devotional service, because many materialistic people are uninterested in Krishna consciousness. They may discourage you, and they may indulge you in materialistic activities, and you become weak in spiritual life. Especially for grihasthas. The example is given, I heard a very beautiful Puranic example. Like the mongoose and the snake, in their battle between the two, sometimes the snake bites the mongoose and kills it. Sometimes the mongoose cuts the snake to pieces and kills it. So who will win, you cannot say. Similarly, materialistic people are like snakes, and devotees are like mongoose. So sometimes matrilocy person defeats the devotee's devotion service and again makes the devotee fall down from his standard. Or sometimes the devotee powerfully preaches to a matrilocy person and makes him a devotee. So who will win? Therefore the Shastras say that what a mongoose does when a snake tries to bite him, he gets a little poison. Immediately he runs to the vanaspati plant and he rolls on it. And then by doing that, the poison goes away. Similarly for grihasthas, the temple is the vanaspati, is contemples. So when they go to offices, they got bitten by bad association, they should come running to the temple and take darshan of the deities. They take darshan of Prabhupada and bow down and take association. And then by that vanaspati, the poisonous effects will be gone. And again they go to office, again they get bitten by bad association, again they should come. And at the same time, what the mongoose does generally, after rolling in the vanaspati and he goes back, he will catch the snake from behind, not from the front. And then he will drag him towards the vanaspati, like that. And then once the snake is brought very close to vanaspati, rolling in the vanaspati plant, the mongoose will cut the snake to pieces and finish him. Similarly, the devotee should bring the non-devotee friends close and close to temple and then gradually destroy the snake-like effects and make them also devotees. Then they will become like another mongoose. So, that is about association. Yeah. Read for that.
A grihastha devotee should perform his prescribed duties and not be indifferent in the name of being detached.
This was told by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to Raghunath Das. He told Raghunath Das, "Hey Raghunath Das, don't be like a Markata Vairagi," he said. Markata means a monkey. A monkey renunciate means a monkey lives in the forest with practically no dress in the body, but the monkey has a dozen she-monkey friends and he is a sense enjoyer. So Mahaprabhu said that your artificial renunciation from grihastha life is not appreciated. You are a married man, you should go back home and you should do the business, earn the money, maintain the wife, maintain the parents and make your family members happy. So I will tell you a simple formula, Lord Chaitanya told him. Please all of you repeat. Manage your business externally.
Manage your business externally.
Meditate on Krishna internally. That's what Lord Chaitanya told him. Manage your business externally and meditate on Krishna internally. Yeah. That means grihasthas should practice renunciation in the heart, not externally. If you try to practice externally like brahmacharis, then you will see there will be a turmoil in the home. Like one time, a husband and wife, they had a big fight problem. And what was the problem all about? The husband became Krishna conscious and he practically shaved like this. He hardly had any hair. And he was wearing very simple dress and his wife and him, they both came to a senior devotee. And the wife was crying that my husband is becoming so callous. Callous means insensitive in the home. So then the senior person asked the husband, what is the matter? He said, "Prabhuji, I am normal. I don't know why is she imagining like that." Then he asked the wife, "What is the problem?" The wife said, "Prabhu, he says that he doesn't need me at all. He doesn't need me. He is happy with Krishna only. He is just chanting and dancing. And he doesn't keep good hair also. He doesn't come for any of the social events of the family. And he keeps aloof. And he tells me that he doesn't need me anymore. And he calls me, I am Maya. Because of me, he will fall down in spiritual life. Don't destroy my spiritual life." These kind of things he talks. Then immediately the senior devotee understood that this fellow is neophyte. He is immature. It's like Markata Vairagi, what Lord Chaitanya told them. He doesn't know the art of conducting the family. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, you should keep renunciation in your heart, not externally, make a show of it. A grihastha man means, you are going to office, you are going to social events, you have to wear nice, neat dress. Modest looking but clean, very nice dress. And also, treat the wife in such a way that she will be very happy. Like Prabhupada talks about Kardamamuni and Devahuti. Kardamamuni, although he was a great renunciate in the forest, after his marriage he gave aerial mansion and then took his wife around, and then he gave her children and everything, and he made her happy. She was a daughter of the king of the world, isn't it? But he remained detached. He did not become carried away by that. In the same manner, Prabhupada says a husband has his duty to earn money, you know, put up a house, you know, provide the facility, give good food, give good dress, ornaments, give children, and then maintain the grihastha ashrama without becoming indifferent in the name of being detached. So these are all a part of the husband's duty. And similarly, the shastras talk about four duties of a wife. It comes in Bhagavatam, 7th canto, you will read it. The wife should be chaste to the husband and should not be frivolous in dealing with other men. And the wife should serve the husband. Like I saw in one colony in Hyderabad, you know, I heard that the entire skyscraper building where IT fellows were living, husband wives, none of the houses had a kitchen, they said. Why? Because they would come down to eat in a mess. Wife will come down and eat at one time and go to company. Husband will come at another time, eat and go. Wife was not cooking anything at home. Wife comes at one time, husband comes at another time. They have different shifts and all that. So I heard that in that building, lot of families got divorced because husband and wife never felt any relationship at all. Because wife never rendered any service. So therefore, there has to be a opportunity for wife to cook at home and offer bhoga to Krishna and then offer the prasad to the husband and children. So therefore, a wife should be chaste and wife should be rendering service, and also wife should know the temperament of the husband and act accordingly. Like in Hindi, they call it garam naram. Garam means hot person, which means angry person. Naram means soft person. So husband is garam, wife should be naram. Or if wife is garam, husband should be naram. Or husband is naram, wife is naram, very good. But both garam, no. That will not work, isn't it? Both are hot-headed. Both the people have head like a matchstick. And also, both are not work like that. It will be like a fire, isn't it? So therefore, she should know the temperament of the husband and accordingly act. And then fourthly, she should know the art of befriending mother-in-law, which is a very big thing. If she can do that, especially mother-in-law and all the in-laws. Because if she keeps the in-laws happy, husband is peaceful. Otherwise, husband has to tackle between mother and wife. He'll be like a mridangam in between, domataka, domataka, both sides. So similarly, husband has a duty, three duties. Bhagavatam also says that protector, provider, guide. He has to protect the wife and family members physically, emotionally. And he is a provider, which means he has to have a job, he has to bring money, put up the family. And guide means he should take guidance from a guru. And then he should offer guidance to the family members. In this way, both husband and wife should contribute their part to the family and make it a sweet family, like they say, sweet home. Read the next one.
He should not be excessively attached to homely comforts in the company of wife, children, relatives, etc.
Yeah. Nowadays people say, you know, Prabhu, why to go to temple so far? 1 hour I have to travel. Now we have a net available. You know, whatever lecture Maharaj gives will come in the YouTube. You know, me, wife, children, we can just put it on at home. We can hear it. So then they say like that, then they are lazy to go to the temple. And what happens at home, when the time of the lecture comes, you know, they are forgetful because they are busy with something at home. Some phone calls came, some neighbor came, you're talking, and then you find more than half the lecture is over, isn't it? And then afterwards you start the lecture, already lecture is half over. You put it on, but then everybody is already busy with some activity. They are going, coming, watching partly and not watching partly, so one may take it very lightly. But imagine taking the wife and children in a car and going to the temple, parking the car, going and taking darshan of the deities and sitting and hearing lecture in front of the spiritual master, asking questions. Is it the same? Hearing in a YouTube at home and going. It makes a big difference, isn't it? So therefore, one should know. Of course, now where there's a period of lockdown, we can't do that. But when lockdown period is lifted, when there's an opportunity to personally associate with Guru, one should take advantage of that and not get stuck in the homely comforts, he's saying. Yeah. Yeah. How does a grihastha practice detachment? Yeah.
Detachment from one's children, wife and home does not mean that one should have no feelings for them. They are natural objects of our affection. But when they are not favorable for our Krishna consciousness, one should not be attached to them. However, sincere...
Like for example, when they are not favorable for our Krishna consciousness, one should not be attached to them. Which means, for example, Duryodhana was not favorable to Krishna. He's called as Krishna Dvit. Krishna Dvit means enemy. He was envious of Krishna. But Dhritarashtra was attached to him. Because he was attached to somebody who is envious of Krishna, the whole dynasty was finished. You will see that. So people who are envious of Krishna, anti-Krishna, then they are likely to indulge in activities that Krishna's movement does not permit. And if we are attached to them, we are also likely to degrade. For example, some boys were meat eaters before. Now they became devotees. They gave up meat eating. But they were attached to some friends very much from their village days, you know, who were meat eaters. Now, one is a non-meat eater, one is a meat eater. When they keep meeting, what happens? When they meet each other, then the meat eater tells him, "Arey, once in a while it's all right, please take." And then he also takes. And that is how one falls. So if a calf associates with a pig, then calf will eat something dirty. But if a calf associates with another calf, he'll drink milk. So therefore he is saying that in a family sometimes it is seen that... So I had put a picture for this in the beginning, where one was a non-devotee family, one is a devotee family. But it is not black and white like this in every family. Sometimes you find that, you know, husband is a devotee, wife is not. Or sometimes wife is a devotee, husband is not. Or husband and wife both are wonderful devotees, but the parents are not inclined to Krishna consciousness. They are worshipping some demigods. So within one family itself, sometimes you find some people not interested. So here comes the challenge. Similarly, students also, their parents are not yet devotees, but students have become devotees. So this is a very great art on how to deal with them in a very mature way. Like parents, they worry about the academics of the boy. They worry about his job and his future. And when they see him wearing tilak, chanting and all, they get very disturbed. If he's becoming so spiritual minded, then how will he settle in his life? So one has to know the parents' interests and accordingly fulfill their interests. Like you ask any parent, what is your, you know, what do you expect from your sons? They will say, I want my son to be like a great hero. He should go abroad and publish some paper. Or he should, you know, get some prizes in the college. He should be smart in studies. He should get distinction in his studies. And he should be very cheerful. He should be very dashing and dynamic. And very bold, he should be, he should have a friend circle and he should be, he should do smart business or at least to take a, get a very good job. So that we can also tell other people how our son is doing. Correct, no? Every son or daughter, every parent wants them to, you know, materially be very progressive. Now if you have become a devotee now, Hare Krishna devotee, you think that, oh, I just want to go back to Godhead, and I'm not interested in academics, I'm not interested in getting high marks, you know, and whether I get a job or not, you know, whenever Krishna sends a job, it will come. You don't take initiative. Then what happens? Parents become wild. Hey, this Hare Krishna has spoiled you. You are not getting very good marks. You are not getting a job. So therefore, those who are serious devotees, it is in their interest to take care of the academics or the job situation, everything, to keep the family members peaceful and happy. Just like, I'll tell you a simple example, you will immediately understand it. There were two dogs which were tied with a rope in their necks. So one dog was very fond of biscuits, and in this corner, a lot of biscuits were there. Another dog was very fond of bread, and in that corner, there was bread. So this dog was looking there and this dog was looking here. They were pulling the rope again and again. Do you think they will get it? So this dog said, biscuit, biscuit. That dog said, bread, bread. And morning to evening they were pulling and barking at each other. They could not get. And a very simple, in the same manner, parents are talking about material life, material life. Beta, you have to get good marks. You have to go abroad. You have to publish some paper in conference. And you have to be popular. Get some medal. Get some something to, for us to show off to our relatives, do something, be smart, be bold, you know, don't be just sitting with the mala like a Sadhu Baba or something like that. You know, parents, they are like the bread-wala dog. And the other dog is saying, biscuit, that is what the son is saying. Oh, I want to chant Hare Krishna, I want to go to ISKCON temple, I want to go to Yatra, I want to wear simple dhoti kurta, I want to wear a beautiful tilak, I want to read Prabhupada books, and I want to attend YouTube lectures, isn't it? So, he is interested in this, they are interested in this. So, two dogs can be pulling and fighting like anything. So, therefore, a devotee should be intelligent. Now, if the two dogs go there, and that fellow picks up the bread, and again the two dogs go here and they pick up the biscuit, then they can come here in the center, and you eat biscuit and you eat bread. Both are happy, correct, no? In order to do that, we should know how to bend ourselves. So, when the boys go home, the youths go home, they have to know mother, father, they love me so much. They want to see me, you know, succeed in my life. Therefore, they are angry with me. Behave with them very lovingly, very kindly, courteously, be cheerful. Take initiative in material life also and get good marks, get good score, get a good degree, get good jobs, and then bring them happiness. So their mind is peaceful, then they will give you freedom to do spiritual life. Same with husband. Like here, look at this husband. His wife wants to go to temple. She is a pious lady. She wants to go and offer some puja in ISKCON temple. And the husband is a big businessman, he has no time. But he knows that wife wants me to be a devotee like her. Let me cooperate. So he's also coming here. So read below that the yellow box.
They are natural objects of our affection. But
they means the wife, children, family members, yeah.
But when they are not favorable for our Krishna consciousness, one should not be attached to them.
Yeah, one should not be attached to them means one can be affectionate to them, but not become attached to them. See, difference between affection and attachment is affection means you show them affection, but you don't get dragged into material life by them. And attachment means like Dhritarashtra's attachment to Duryodhana, like that, yeah.
However, sincere efforts to make them Krishna conscious should not be given up.
One should endeavor. So, yeah, and then the process of Krishna consciousness is very simple and joyous to perform. Every Krishna should endeavor to train his family members in Krishna consciousness. In such a household, where all members are Krishna conscious, there is no need to change from family life to renounced life, Prabhupada says. That means one husband-wife, they wrote to Prabhupada, wife told that, Prabhupada, I have given permission to my husband to take sannyas. Because he has been a very good grihastha till now, he wants to take sannyas and I have no reservations. We both were very good spiritual partners till now and he is very fired up, he wants to take sannyas. And the husband also wrote to Prabhupada, Prabhupada, I am thinking of sannyas. Prabhupada said, why do you want to take sannyas? You and your wife are doing so much hard work, so many services day in and day out. I consider both of you like the best of sannyasis, he said. So continue in your family and continue your services. Like that he said. So, this is one last line. Yeah.
How does a grihastha practice detachment?
Yeah.
Giving in charity, a sacred duty in grihastha ashram. Giving in charity and serving guests make grihastha ashram most auspicious.
See, a grihastha ashrama is the ashrama which supports other three, brahmachari, vanaprastha, sannyas. All three are supported by the grihastha ashrama. So, this is one of the ways to develop detachment. Somebody may say, you know, I want to live with wife and children and have affection for them. Okay, but you give charity. By giving charity, one will gradually uplift oneself in spiritual life because one purifies one's earning. And that way the heart becomes purified. Yes.
A grihastha makes spiritual advancement by giving in charity to the other three ashram as which are meant exclusively for making spiritual progress. They are not supposed to be burdened with the problem of earning a livelihood for food, clothing and shelter. This is the inherent strength and also the beauty of grihastha ashram. It is a benediction. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that charity should be given in the right consciousness.
Sattvagana, to the right person, in the right time and place, he says. Therefore, the householders, you can read 12.10, Prabhupada says, the householders should be sympathetic to the preachers of Krishna consciousness movement. And they should support them by giving them a piece of land or giving them some money. If you don't have a land or money, then you can physically come and offer some seva support, give some services. So, here also he says that the householders should give donations on a regular basis to the temple, even very little, if that is all they have. They should cultivate this habit right from the beginning of their life in Krishna consciousness. Some devotees think that they will wait until they make a lot of money and then they can give a lot to Krishna. They think like that. But giving in charity regularly from whatever material wealth the Lord provides helps us in our Krishna consciousness. Actually, whatever you little, you keep giving, and that purifies our heart also little. It keeps on purifying. Yeah? Otherwise, what happens when we have wealth more, we misuse it for sense gratification. So, grihastha can develop detachment in various ways. One of the ways is prominently giving some 10% of one's earning to Krishna's service. That is one of the ways. Similarly, one should not develop attachment to non-devotees. And if there are non-devotee relatives, deal with them respectfully, affectionately, without walking their wrong path. You don't take their wrong association, you give them good association. And then we also learnt about do's and don'ts, we learnt. And then some small services that they can do. So these are all some pointers I am giving you, which will be very easy to apply in grihastha life. You understood the difference between grihastha is Krishna-centered and grihamedi is sense gratification-centered. So Prabhupada doesn't condemn family life. He says that if a husband, wife, children are... See, even this small kid is also raising hand and enjoying the kirtan. You see? So then it's a wonderful family. They are just like sannyasis, Prabhupada says. As good as sannyasis, they are absorbed in Krishna consciousness. And a real life example is Bhaktivinoda Thakur and his family members. You are showing this? And the family life is a stumbling block, Prabhupada says, when family members become attached to each other, forgetful of Krishna, and they run after money making and they don't devote time for chanting Hare Krishna, hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, hearing the lectures. So a grihastha should know that the material body in which I am seated now is temporary, and if I make sense gratification the goal of my life, I have to be repeatedly born. And if I make Krishna the goal, gradually I can rise, elevate myself above. So you can also read the 7th canto, 14th chapter at your leisure, and that will teach many valuable tips on dealing with family attachment in a very successful way and becoming Krishna conscious. Thank you. Let us take some questions now. Mahalakshmi Mataji is asking from Pondicherry. This is a question from yesterday's class. You told faith in Krishna is needed for going through the reversal, but I am not having faith and having so much fear for suffering. What should I do to get strong faith that Krishna is my protector? Actually, I am planning in the next few days. Today I spoke about, what is the topic today again? Dealing with family attachment. So tomorrow I wanted to talk about profession. Attitude towards profession. Tomorrow I will talk about that. And the day after, I was planning to speak about the how to experience shelter. Krishna's shelter, how we can experience it. So there the topic of faith will come. So in the next 2-3 days faith will come. You can wait and watch. You will get to hear about it, okay? And Srinivas Prabhu is asking in Kolkata, how can we increase our mind effectiveness and focus to carry on my day without taking sleep during the day in case we didn't get proper sleep during night? Only 4 hours, and I had to wake up in the morning to chant in case. Okay, see, if you got only 4 hours sleep, then you can take some rest during the day. There's no problem. Probably you will need 1 hour at least. So once in a while you got less rest in the night, then daytime you can catch up. I have an experience. Some days I slept only 4 hours at night, and in the daytime I was working very hard. Like in the afternoon or sometime, you'll be forced to fall on the ground, lie, and then you sleep without even making effort. And then suddenly you look at the clock, 45 minutes, 1 hour you have slept, then you go and wash your face. The body forces you to compensate for the rest, like that. But what we condemn is, night you have slept 5-6 hours, and daytime also you want to sleep another 2 hours, then one becomes very lazy. Anirudh was asking, Sometimes parents feel left out when we do devotion. They sometimes force us into materialism. How to tackle it? See, the word materialism is too general. You have to say, what are they trying to force you into? In that there are very clearly, you know, three zones. White zone, black zone, grey zone. So you have to say, this materialism, what you are talking. Sometimes they may tell you to do something materialistic, you may say, what is it? Sometimes they may say, let us go for some demigod temple or something like that. You may say like that. So you can go with them sometimes, that's not a very serious problem or something like that. Or sometimes they do some family puja for some devata, they ask you to sit also, come and watch the program. You don't have to hurt their sentiments. You can just sit for their pleasure. These kind of things you can do. And they may say, we are going to meet our Gurudev, who is a Kula Guru, who is not a Vaishnava, is a Mayavadi or something. So you also come with us, whole family is going, 30-40 of us are going to that village. Okay, for parents' pleasure you can go. With everybody you may just go and come, you also offer obeisances and come back. You know, you don't talk anything. But you may, so in this way sometimes these things are not a big problem, just to cooperate with the parents you do. Sometimes they call it to relatives' home, okay, go with them. Now there is a black zone. What is black zone? Parents say, beta, if you really love us, you have to eat meat. They say, that is a black zone. That means they are telling you to do sinful activity. And they say that if you really love us, you have to watch TV with us. Okay, what are they asking you to watch? If you are watching materialistic serials, which are no substance, you can watch for a few minutes, maybe 5-10 minutes for their pleasure. Then you go into the kitchen and bring some chips and give everybody little chips. All of you take this, take that, you go here, go there. And you have given them company for a short while, you push off, go to another room, you can go. You have given some company to them and you can tell them, you have your taste, I have my taste. But I am trying to cooperate with you and you are also kindly giving me your cooperation and let's go together. And you are a grown-up boy, you can be very frank in talking. And we can be as kind as possible to them. So that mentalism, is it in a white zone or black zone? Some are in grey zone. So you have to find out what it is. Why they feel left out? Sometimes they feel that you are too much in devotion service and not caring for the mother. Mother generally feels caring when, like I used to go in my engineering days to home. And I used to purchase some sari and take for my mother. For my sisters, I used to carry some earrings or bangles. Very cheap. You know, even though the cost is not much, but what matters is not the cost. Oh, my brother remembered to bring me some bangles. He brought me some earrings. So they feel very happy. Similarly, you meet the father, you ask about his job, ask about his business, spend some time. You think, oh, that is not Krishna conscious. No, may not be Krishna conscious, but that is what will make them comfortable. So it's our duty to make them comfortable, then they will not feel left out. When the father has a business, son can go with the father, sit with him in a business for some time. Harshad was asking, can a devotee chant after a family member passed away? We follow 13 days Sutak period while worshipping. Chanting is not allowed. So can we connect with Krishna during this period? Or we should stop everything during Sutak period for 13 days? Actually 13 days you can chant 64 rounds every day. That will be very good, if you can. Because you have to chant for them also, no? Yeah. In fact, I will tell you what we did when my mother, father passed. You know, morning we called the Sri Vaishnava Brahmana. With him, the early morning I went to my home myself and chanted with all my sisters, my husband, children, keeping our mother, father photo, and we also kept them. And then we were chanting in the morning. And many temple brahmacharis, every day 5 brahmacharis I took in the morning to chant with the family. And in the evening, one grihastha or brahmachari gave a lecture for about 2 hours, every day evening. And between 10 to 1, I did all the kriyas and all to be done, along with the Sri Vaishnava Brahmana, putting the pinda and all that, because my father and mother both wanted me to do that. I took permission from my spiritual master and I did that for them. So, and in the afternoon, between 1 to 4, I will also sit with the family and talk to them. Because they have lost a very near and dear relative, they will feel very left out. So I would spend some time with them. So in this way, It was completely Krishna Mayam. My sisters were telling me that we didn't feel the pinch of the 13 days, that we lost our very near person, because it was complete spiritual absorption. So you have the same opportunity. We should be all the more Krishna conscious during this time of 13 days. And the people who say that you should not do religious things, go to temple and everything, there is some amount of impurity associated with somebody passing away in a family. So we don't go to the temple. Even I also didn't enter the temple hall, 13 days. But I didn't miss the Mangalarti. I was standing outside and attending Mangalarti. And I chanted also outside. And we took part, and then after 13 days we went in. So because my father wanted us to follow all these things for those 13 days, so we followed it. So our Krishna consciousness need not be compromised. I don't know whether you are aware, women have those 3 days in a month period. Even in that, they can go to the temple. Only they cannot water Tulasi. And they can touch the bead bag. And they can chant also. Chanting is not a problem. Only they don't water the Tulasi in the temple. So in this way, you can see, like one meat-eating autowala was telling that, Swamiji, I eat meat, so I can't touch the Bhagavad Gita. I said, therefore you have to read Bhagavad Gita, isn't it? That's no problem. One more question Ashish was asking. How can I convince elderly people in family to do Krishna Bhakti? In my family, elderly people are resistant to change. And how can I change their mindset and take them to Krishna consciousness? Once I tried to convince, but they became very angry. Shall I stop convincing? Yeah, you should stop convincing now. Instead, serve them lovingly. Massage your grandfather's feet. Yeah. If grandmother is cooking, go and cut sabji for her. In the kitchen, and tell your grandmother and grandfather, I'll personally catch you your hand and take you to the doctor. Silently serve them. They should be so amazed by your service attitude, they will ask you, please get us one mala and bead bag. We also want to chant like you. You try to please them, then they will try to please you. And you don't serve them, you go and demand them, why are you not Krishna conscious? You are very old, anytime you will die. Better you take the mala and chant. If you say like that, they'll get wild. So therefore, the same principle applies in a family also, husband, wife, children. Then if you actually render some service, they'll be eager to follow what you are saying. Mahaprabhu is asking, if Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Raghunath Das Goswami, how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left Grihastha life himself and not suggested Raghunath Das Goswami to leave home? No, Raghunath Das Goswami also left home later. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted him later. But at that particular stage, he told him to go home. Similarly, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also, at the age of 24, he left. Although his mother was a widow, his wife was very beautiful and humble and submissive, everything. There is a whole verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Even like Buddha, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, these are all incarnations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Very special, very extraordinary people are allowed to leave like that for the sake of the world. Just like, for example, if a soldier is leaving behind a crying mother and going to fight Kargil war for a higher duty for the nation's sake, he is ready to forego the family. He may even die in the war also, but he is doing it for the nation, which is a greater cause than a small family. Similarly, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also left a smaller family to do a greater work for the bigger family of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, for that. But Raghunath Das Goswami had to do some duty for a while, after which Mahaprabhu allowed him to join him. In student life, when we go home, we should behave like Grihastha or Brahmachari Prabhuji, like shaving head, not going to social events like functions and all. Can you please elaborate? No, actually, most of our boys will enter the Grihastha ashrama. But if you are going to be a Brahmachari, for example, you have a plan to join the ashram. Like when I used to go home, my parents used to go to relatives' home. I used to go with them. What is the problem? Is a Brahmachari not allowed to go to relatives' home? What is the problem? Sometimes they travel to relatives' homes. We go. And I used to tell my aunt, please kindly offer this. If you want, you cook and give me. I will offer the boga to Krishna. And they are all very pious people. They already have Krishna photo in the altar. They also sing Krishna bhajans and everything. So we can offer the boga and then give prasad to everybody. We don't have to make a big issue. You people are eating that which is not prasad. I will not touch it. Instead of saying that, we can always offer it ourselves and then give everybody. Like in case you don't like to go to a social event, you have to see how damaging it may be for you. Actually, if you are in your whole family is going, you know, and you also going with them, I don't see any serious problem in that. Srinivas Balasubramaniam, Prabhu is asking, should we think before giving charity to unprivileged people like somebody suffering from some disease or those advertised in NGO website that some child is suffering from dangerous disease? Is it true that charity should be given to a devotee of the Lord who are under the protection of the Lord or in service of the Lord instead to people who are under the three modes of material world? Sattva, Rajas, Tamas. Actually, if you go, there are so many people dying every day. The number of people dying in accidents, number of people dying in diseases, and the number of people dying in suicides. If you go and see the number, what is the number? It's a big number of people pass away. But if you give people who are preaching Krishna consciousness or to the temple for the Lord's service or devotee service, then the devotees are doing one particular type of work, which is taking the jivas out of this world and sending them to the spiritual world. So if you are assisting it, that at least you are saving some souls from getting out of the world and going back to their original home. Correct, no? Otherwise, all other services is considered mundane, which is not spiritual. So it's your choice. You are a jiva, you have the choice. You can understand what is mundane, what is divine, you decide. Sometimes like now, due to financial crisis, reducing employees happening. Now you have no job, difficult to manage situation at home. How to manage? Situation is not in full control of ours. Currently searching for job. How to keep parents peaceful and also stay in association of devotees? Keep our freedom continued. Yeah. So, because many people are losing jobs and everything, you can also consider learning some skill. Our even Prime Minister of India is talking about Skill India. Why? Because if you have a skill, you don't have to depend on somebody. You can use the skill and earn, make your earning, and parents will be happy that my son is not idling at home. He's going and learning some skills, and he will set up his own thing and he will make money through that. There are dozens and dozens of skills are being introduced in India nowadays. Because 18 lakh engineers are passing out of the college, only 3 lakh are getting jobs. Other 5 lakh go for masters. And what do you think 10 lakh engineers are doing? Many of the engineers are becoming Uber Ola drivers nowadays. So therefore, it is in your interest. There are many things we could do. Skill-based talent. And then you learn those skills and parents will see that you are taking initiative, not idling. Okay, one devotee is asking. Yeah? One more? Anirudh Prabhu? Okay. Demigods are known to bestow various mental benedictions on their followers. Since Goddess Lakshmi is known, Goddess of Fortune, bestower of wealth. Is Goddess Lakshmi a demigoddess? Goddess of Lakshmi is an expansion of Narayana. I mean, she is a Ardhangini, better half of Lord Narayana. But if Goddess Lakshmi is worshipped alone without Narayana, then she can be disastrous, like what Ravana did. He took Sita away from Ram, then he was destroyed. Because you will see, Goddess Lakshmi, her Vahana is what? Her Vahana is Owl. Owl is awake when? Whole night, the owl is awake. Similarly, people who are all the time after money, they are awake only in darkness. They are awake only in darkness, not in the daylight. Similarly, the Lakshmi has two aspects. She can act, she can behave like a demigod who can actually, one can, like we say, Sita and Maya Sita, we say, no? In the same manner, if one wants to handle Lakshmi without Narayana, then one can suffer what Ravana suffered. But therefore, you worship the divine couple together, Lakshmi Narayan, Sita Ram, Radha Krishna, like that we worship. Okay. And, okay. No, one more is there. Sometimes, okay. PG. If I am neutral for marriage, should I proceed it for it if my family wants? Yeah, if you are neutral for marriage, means you are actually better fit for a family life. Because those who are brahmacharis are very clear. They will not, they don't want to go for family life and they want to actually proceed in. If somebody is saying, I'm not clear, then they should go for married life, preferably. But they should take responsibility. One shouldn't say that my parents told me I'm married, but now I don't like her, I want to divorce. That is not good. Whatever you do in life, take responsibility. If a boy or girl in Krishna consciousness in their young age, how should they live in future? As Grihastha Brahmachari, Shravya Nandita is asking. Many says that it all depends on their wish, but what how to choose? Myself, Shravya, And how can I choose between grihastha life or brahmachari life? Actually, if you are a girl, Prabhupada says that girls always, it's best for them to get married. If you live like a spinster alone, now your parents are taking care of you now. A girl should always be under the protection of a male member. Now your father is taking care of you. Later on when you grow older, they get older, then you can't be alone. A woman always, then she should have a husband to take care of her. Then when husband, if he takes sannyas, then son will take care of her. So it is good for a girl to always be in the safe protection of a man. Because you will see in this world, when a girl walks alone, many boys are staring at her. Immediately imagine her husband is coming from behind with a big mustache. Aye, then all of them will run away. Isn't it? As soon as a man is there with a woman, people deal with her respectfully. So it is in the interest of the woman to be protected. And if you are a devotee girl, then you marry a devotee boy. And in this way, you can lead a very nice grihastha, ideal grihastha life. Okay. Shuprabhu, last two questions, okay. Actually, if you try to renounce in heart and attach it externally, behavior becomes very artificial and we can't carry out it for long. Means it's inside something, else outside something. No, it is not inside something, outside something. Actually, you are renounced inside the heart and outside you are doing it for the sake of keeping peace and order, which will help your inside. For example, like when Raghunath Das was earning good money and making business, parents were completely peaceful. They gave him full freedom to do Krishna consciousness. But if he shows externally that I am not interested in family life, then what happens? They will curb his Krishna consciousness. They will stop it. Then your so-called internal vairagya cannot remain. There will be a big fight at home. So it is not inside, outside. You are inside also, you are renounced. Outside also, you are renounced. You are actually renounced. You are very eager to advance. But externally, you do it as a duty. Just like many students don't like to study the college subjects, but they study as a duty. Similarly, husband, he has to do all the duties at home so that his Krishna consciousness can be peaceful. And it's not my instruction. Lord Chaitanya gives an instruction to Raghunath Das. Manage your business externally, meditate on Krishna internally. And for sadhus like me, our renunciation should be internal or external? Both. It's not only external, not that you are externally renounced and internally is a sense gratifier, no. We should be internally and externally renounced. And grihastha means renunciation is internal, but externally they do the duties of the family. Last question, Srinivas Basamunyam. Can a Vaishnava worship Lord Shiva to get grace of Lord Krishna, or he should worship only Krishna as mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, where he mentions, does Lord Shiva classify as a saint or devotee of Lord Krishna? Yeah. One can worship Shiva and pray to him that please kindly make me a pure devotee of Krishna, just like Prachetas did in Srimad Bhagavatam 4th canto. That is perfect. But if you go to Shiva treating him like a demigod, like what Ravana did, then we suffer. Thank you, I completed all the questions. Today it became very late because we started very late today. We had some problem of connection. We are very sorry to delay all of you. I will never go generally beyond 8:40.